我们今天是四世纪的第六章，
Today we shall read Judges chapter 6.
我们就到第五个士师。
We have come to the fifth judge.
这个士师呢，在四世纪里面记录的最多、最详细、最多教训的一个士师。
We see a lot of recording and a lot of teachings about this judge.
那第六章是记录基甸被烧蒙神恩召。第六章，
Chapter 6 records the calling of Gideon by God.
那第七章是基甸的得胜，撒地人得胜。
In Chapter 7, we see the victory of Gideon against the
那第
enemies.
八章就记录到他的得胜后的生活跟管理，跟治理以色列。
And in Chapter 8, we see after victory, the way he handled the people.
那这第六章呢？我们先来读，一个人读四节是吗？十四个人
三
读，
节，三
十
节，
四个人读，一个人读三节。
yeah. There are 14 of us reading. Each of us reading 3 verses.
请念。好，感谢主，谢谢各位读经的兄弟姐妹，谢谢。
We thank God and we thank our brothers and sisters who have read the Bible.
这一段一共传道把它分成五段。
I divide this chapter into 5 sections.
第一段是以色列受欺压的岁月，那个是个悲惨的岁月。
The first section talks about the oppression by the enemies.
那是一节到六节。
It is from verse 1 to verse 6.
第二节就是第二段是神差遣先知是去责备以色列民。
The second section talks about how God sent this prophet to admonish the Israelites.
那七节到十节。
Verses 7 to 10.
第三段是神向基甸显现，那个就是神蒙召这个基甸选召基甸。
The third section talks about the appearance of God, before Gideon to call him.
那是11节到24节。
This is from verses 11 to 24.
第四段是神叫基甸拆毁偶像的祭坛。
The fourth section talks about God asking Gideon to take down the altar.
那也叫做神考验基甸，这一段也看到神在考验基甸。
This is also the section where God was testing Gideon.
那是25到32节。
25 to verse 32.
那对最后一段呢，是基甸向神拯救的证据。
The last section talks about the sign that Gideon asked from God as a sign for deliverance.
这是33节到40节了。
Verses 33 to 40.
那这一章呢，我传道分三个不同的角度来去分享。
I divided this into three perspectives, three angles for us to ponder.
第一个角度叫做危机跟转机，转机跟危机当，危机跟危机就是转机啊，危机当中看到转机。
The first angle is from crisis, we can see the turning point.
那第二个方向是基甸蒙召的一些分享。
The second angle is from the perspective of Gideon when he was called by God.
那第三个角度呢？从这章我们看到有五种鲜明的对比，简单说就是有五件宝贵的真理。
The fifth angle is the five types of teachings that we can derive from this chapter.
好，那这一章的大主题叫做基甸蒙召。我们先从这一章是神选召基甸这个角度。
So the theme for this chapter is the calling of Gideon.
危机我们先看，以色列人的危机在哪里？
Let us see where is the crisis that was faced by the Israelites.
这里有三个危机。
Here we can see three crises.
从第一节呢，我们看到信仰的破产，以色列人信仰的破产，已经完全失败，完全失败。
Here, verse 1, we can see the degradation of the faith of the Israelites.
那第一节就介绍了他们行耶和华看为恶的事。
Verse 1 tells us that the Israelites did evil in the sight of God.
那第十节说他们做什么恶事呢？他们主要就是敬拜迦南地的偶像，敬拜假神啊。
What kind of evil did they do? Verse 4 tells us that they worship the idols of Baal.
那在这个信仰破产当中，我们看到他们很快就忘记神40年的 40年给他们平安的见证，平安的生活。
And in this period of evilness that they committed against God, they forgot the peace that God gave them for a total of 40 years.
而且那个40年就是在第四章底波拉、哦、跟巴拉、所得胜回来的、啊、靠着神所得胜回来的40年。
The 40 years of peace was obtained when Deborah and Barak fought a victorious battle.
那个是个很荣耀神、很辉煌的战绩、得胜，很辉煌的得胜。
That was a very victorious and glorious battle that they fought in.
但是以色列人却忘恩负义啊，把神的恩典跟平安忘记了，跑去拜偶像了。
But the Israelites forgot the grace of God and they turned to the idols and worship.
这个是危机的第一段，第一个危机，信仰的破产。
This is the first crisis, the degradation of their faith.
第二个危机呢，就是受仇敌的、受敌人的欺压。
The second crisis is the oppression by the enemies.
那三节到四节，这里有记录他们受欺压的生活的情形啊，凄凉的情形。
Verses 3 to 4, we can see how pitiful their lives were when they were being oppressed.
特别这个敌人有三种，一个是米甸人，一个是亚玛利人，一个是东方人，看到吗？
There were three types of enemies, the Midianites, the Amalekites, and the people of the East.
在第三节。
That is in verse 3.
那米甸人是谁知道吗？
Who are these Midianites?
米甸人就是亚伯拉罕的儿子来的呀。
The Midianites were actually the children of Abraham.
亚伯拉罕的太太撒拉死了，他不是娶第二个老婆吗？就是第二个老婆生的孩子叫米甸啊，他的孩子其中一个叫做米甸，就是亚伯兰的，也是亚伯兰的后裔来的呀。
So, when Sarah died.Abraham married another wife, and the children of this wife was called the Midianites.
如果我没有记错，他第二个老婆生的也是十二个孩子，是吗？如果我没有记错了，是吗？试试看。
If I'm not mistaken, his other wife had also 12 children.
而且这十二个孩子都是族长啊，都是一个族一个族的族长啊，酋长来的呀。
And all these 12 children, they were tribal leaders.
那么亚玛利人呢？亚玛利人大家都很熟悉哦，就是那个也是亚伯拉罕的儿子所生的。
We are also familiar with the Amalekites. They were also the descendants of Abraham.
是吗？他的祖这个亚玛利人的祖父应该就是那个什么呀？叫什么名字啊？那跟夏甲生的呀。
These Amalekites were born of Hagar.
你还知道吗？我忘记了。以斯玛利亚。
Ishmaelites.
好，那东方人是指今天的亚拉伯人呐、
And the people of the East refers to the Arabs of today.
那么这个以色列人当时呢，在第六章里面，他们主要的敌人就是这三个了。而且被这三个敌人来包围呀、啊，来围困上。
In verse 3, we can see that they were surrounded by these enemies, Midianites, Amalekites, and people of the east.
而且他们常常在他们撒种的时候，第三节丰收的时候，他们就来抢他们的粮食、啊、全部抢走。
And very often, during the period of harvest, they will come and take all their produce.
那第五节说，这些敌人多到好像蝗虫这样多、啊、那意思很多的意思。
Verse 5 tells us that they were so numerous like locusts.
那他们一来的时候呢，所有的事物啊，牛羊啊，产业啊，各种生活的用品都被他们掳去啊，一样都不留下的。
And when the enemies come, they will plunder the whole land, taking away all the livestock and all the produce of the land.
那么你吃什么呢？你本来丰收哦，这么辛苦种来的米啊，那些稻啊，丰收了，感谢主有的吃了，就被他们抢走，那你吃什么呢？
So what is there left for the people to eat? Everything that they harvested has all been taken away.
当时的食物就是种的东西啊，还有牛跟羊啊，主要就是这两种呀、啊，当时。
So what is important is the livestock and the produce of the land.
所以你就可以想象他们的生活是非常凄惨的，食物不够的，吃不饱的。
So you can imagine how they lead their life at that time. They were not full. They cannot be filled.
那么第五节让我们看到当时的生活文化。第五节这里说他们已经有骆驼了，这个是圣经很少记录到的，他们已经有骆驼，用骆驼来印在东西啊。
Verse 5, you can see their civilization. They already had camels at that time.
而且骆驼可以走很远，可以走很远的路啊，可以走很远的路。
Camels, they can travel very far.
让我们看到当时的他们的生活的一些状况啊，一些情形。
So this, from here we can see the kind of environment they live in at that time.
那么这个就是第二个危机哈，被敌人围困、被敌人欺压的第二个危机。
So this is the second crisis. They were surrounded by the enemies and they were being oppressed.
那么这个第三个危机呢？他们苟且偷生。什么叫苟且偷生？苟且偷生就是说，你好像个老鼠这样活得好。躲躲藏藏的来生活，不敢光明正大的来生活。
And the third crisis is they have to live their life secretly. They do not dare to live their life openly.
甚至他们是住在山洞里或者地洞里。
And to the extent that they have to live in caves or in dens.
那在第二节我们看到啊，第二节。
We can see this in verse 2.
因为这些敌人哦，他们就在山中挖穴。挖洞建造营寨，就是过很躲躲藏藏的那种很可怜的生活了。
So we can see that they live in the caves and the dens in the strongholds in the mountain. So they are living a very secretive and primitive kind of life.
所以特别十一节我们看到一个现象哦，基甸十一节下半段哦，那个基甸在那边打麦子的时候，你看他在哪里打麦子？他在酒闸里面打麦子啊，打麦子应该是要在广场嘛，在宽阔的地方打麦嘛。他跑去酒闸那边打麦，酒闸就是洞啊，或者挖地洞啊，或者山洞里面打。
Verse 11, we can see that this Gideon, he threshed wheat in the wine press. By right, they should be threshing wheat in the open plains.
他们不敢让敌人看到他们有这些麦子的存在啊，都躲躲藏藏的，偷偷的这样来打麦子啊。
They had to do it secretly in order to hide from the enemies.
从这些的记录当中，我们看到他们生活的危机以及信仰的危机。
From here, we can see that they were really having a crisis in their faith and as well as in their life.
那想想我们今天信仰的状况又怎样呢？有没有这三种危机的存在呢？有没有？
So let us think about it. In our life today, are we facing these two crises?
好，那么他们的转机在哪里呢？
So where is their turning point then?
第一个改变呢，转机呢，是在第七节。
The first turning point is in verse 7.
以色列人因为米甸人的缘故，就求神回来祷告求神。
Because of the oppression of the Midianites, the children of Israel started to pray and cry out to the Lord.
这个是我们懂得跪在神的面前来呼求神的时候，这个就是一个转机。
As long as we know how to repent and cry out to God.This would be our turning point.
但是我们人就是很硬心啊，不愿意哈，真正的来呼求神，跪在神面前求神啊。
But very often men are very hard-hearted. We are not willing to kneel down before God and to cry out to Him.
总之，我们愿意悔改认罪在神面前呼求就是转机的开始，就是神帮助的开始。
As long as we are willing to repent and confess our sins before God and cry out to Him, then that would be the beginning of our turning point, and this is when God will hear us.
那你看，真的就是这样。当他们跪下来呼求神的时候，第八节神就差遣先知来责备他们了。
True enough, when they were willing to humble themselves and cry out to God.God sent this prophet to rebuke them.
神差先知除了责备，其实就是要拯救他们了，也就是要安慰他们了，要帮助他们了。
Apart from rebuking them, God sent this prophet to also comfort and to help them to give them.
因为先知是神的仆人，是替神做工的。
Because prophets are workers of God and they do God's work.
他们为什么要责备？为什么要安慰？哦，为什么要帮助？那就是要拯救呀，要进行信仰的拯救呀。
Why do they rebuke and comfort? It is to deliver and save the Israelites.
但是我也是很有点奇怪哦，在这样的环境当中，还有先知吗？谁是先知呀？
But I am very surprised in this kind of environment. Are there still prophets? And who is this prophet?
但这里明明说神差派先知啊，那让我们感到安慰，就是原来哦，在最糟糕的环境里，最糟糕的信仰里，神还有隐藏一些对神忠心的人，神还是把他们隐藏起来。
But here it's very clear that God sent his prophet. So we can see that in the midst of all these crises, God will still hide his own prophets. And he will, God will still have his own prophets.
那需要的时候，神就用他们，叫把他们显明出来，成为神的工人，成为神所用的人。
And when it is necessary, when the time is come, when God needs them, then God will send them out to warn the people.
那在第六章的先知之前哦，那就在第四章啊。第四章的先知是你先知啊，底波拉也有先知呀。
And before chapter 6, that is in chapter 4, we can see the prophetess, that is Deborah.
让我们得到安慰啦，在我们这么信仰这么破产、这么落败的时候哦。其实神有暗暗的，还是保留一些神，还是有隐藏的先知在我们里面。
So this is where we feel very comforted that in the time of this crisis, God still has His prophets to warn us.
这个就是一个转机的一个第二个重点呢，转机的一个希望。
This is the second point of this turning point, and this is the hope that we can see.
最怕在这个时候连神的工人都没有。没有神的先知与我们同在。
What we are afraid is during this time of crisis, we cannot find any prophet of God.
所以先在这里看到先知存在的价值，它的价值在哪里？
So from here, we can see the value of the existence of these prophets.
特别是在以色列人信仰落败的时候，黑暗的时候，更需要有先知的存在。
Particularly in the dark period of the Israelites when their faith have backslided and they have degraded. So this is important that we see the existence of the prophets.
那先知在原文希伯来文里面有呼喊的意思，喊叫，喊叫或者叫呼喊，喊啊，一直喊，一直喊，喊。
The prophet in the original, they bear the meaning of calling out or they cry out.
这个是很有意思的。
This is very meaningful.
什么时候我们会喊叫，大大声的喊叫，就是我们在危险的时候，甚至是要死亡的时候，我们突然间大大声的喊起来，主啊救我，是不是？哈利路亚，大大声的喊，对不对？
When do we need to call out and to cry out to the Lord in the time of crisis?
先知的意思就是呼喊，从内心里面喊出神的话，从内心里面喊出信仰的危机喊出来，大声叫出来。
So the meaning of prophet is to cry out and to call out to God from the bottom of their heart.
所以你看他讲的话第八节开始对以色列讲的话就是责备嘛，要以色列人悔改嘛。
From verse 8 onwards, you can see that the words of this prophet is to rebuke them, to call them to repent.
重点就是说他们忘恩负义了，忘记神的恩典了。
The main point is because the Israelites have forgotten the grace of God; they were ungrateful.
那么也第十节下半段说，你们竟不听神的话，你们为什么不听神的话
？Verse 10 says, "Why did they not hearken to the voice of God?"
好，那今天的工人，也就是旧约的先知嘛。在这个末世时代也是做这个先知的工作，呼喊，不断的呼喊。
So our workers today, they also call out and cry out just like the prophets of the Old Testament.
但是有人觉得这种先知吵死人啊，听到都烦啊，每天都在喊，很吵啊，很反感啊。
But there are people who resist these preachers because they feel that they have been crying out all the time.
小心你有这种状况的时候，就是当时以色列人对神的先知的态度，真的就是这样。当时他们对先知的态度就是很反感啊，很讨厌啊，整天都在喊，整天都在骂我们， 很讨厌。
We must be watchful. Just if we have this kind of attitude today, then we'll be just like the Israelites who resist the prophets because they call out and cry out to them to repent.
开始只是哈不喜欢，不从从不喜欢到反感，到反感最后把先知哈打死，有一些赶出去，有一些打死。那主耶稣也正视这件事，主耶稣说，哦，在新约主耶稣说，你们从亚伯开始哈，从那个创世纪那边开始，我一直。一直呼叫，一直有神的声音，你们就从亚伯开始就杀我的仆人，杀先知，一直到撒加利亚，主耶稣正视这个事情了。
Initially, we may just be disliking them, but we will grow to an extent of hating and resenting them, just like the words of Jesus in the New Testament when he said that we have killed the prophets.
那么你要了解先知哦，他们为什么要杀先知？你去看先知书嘛，很多先知书啊。旧约不是全部都是先知书吗？你看他们讲话，原来就是一直得罪人啊，一直骂人啊，就是这样被杀掉的。不然他们杀先知做什么？先知又没有做错事，又没有做坏事，又没有出卖国家，又没有出卖民族，他们杀他做什么？
If you were to read the prophetic books of the New Old Testament, we find that they always rebuke the people. Otherwise, why do you think that they have not betrayed the country or they have not betrayed the people?
你会对今天真教会末世的先知反感吗？讨厌吗？甚至哈、不想听看到他，听到他讲，他听到他在发出呼喊的声音。
Do you dislike？
你会这样吗？
Do you dislike and resent the preachers or the ministers, the workers today in our church？
但无论如何，在信徒怎样不喜欢先知的时的情形哦，神仍然会有。会安排先知的出现，感谢神。
But we thank God that no matter how the people would dislike and hate or resent the prophets, God will still arrange for them to appear in times of crisis.
就是让你还可以听到神的话了，听到从神来的警告了。
That is to say, we still have the opportunity to come to listen to God's words.
好，我们第二段哈，我们借第二个角度，刚才是。危机跟转机啊！现在我们来看基甸蒙召，神蒙召基甸。
We've talked about the crisis and the turning point. Now we talk about the calling of Gideon.
那第一呢？哈、哦，是神主动的来选召他。
The first thing is we must know that God called Gideon out of His own will.
那是在十一节哈、哦，神主动的向他显现哦，不是人主动，是神在主动啊。
So from verse 11, we see that it was God who manifested himself to Gideon.
这个你就明白为什么主耶稣说、哦、在约翰福音书15:16说，不是你们拣选我，是我拣选你们。但重点是说，因为神主动召我，选召我们，神在主动来做拯救。
So we can see this in John chapter 15 that Jesus said He is the one who called us and not we call Him.Not be chosen. So in this case, also God chose Gideon.
第二呢，神就给同在的应许啊，十六节神同在的应许。
Secondly, we can see in verse 16 that God promised Gideon that he would be with him.
那第三点呢，神还给确实的证据，21节哈，正是神同在的证据。
In verse 31, God gave a very sure sign that He is with God is with Gideon.
这三个重点呢，都看到神慈爱的作为，神拯救的作为来的。
From these three points, we can see, the gracious work, of His deliverance.
第一，神主动拣选；第二，神允许同在的允许要跟我们同在；第三，同在的证据。这三点。
First, God called Gideon. Secondly, God promised him that He would be with him. And thirdly, God gave him this sign.That he will be with him.
好，现在我们来思想一下，为什么神会选召基甸呢？他有什么特别的地方呢？
Now let us see what is the special characteristic of Gideon that God would call him.
那你看，神选召他的时候，他在做什么？他正在劳动啊，在做工啊，在勤劳的做工作呀。
Let's see what he was doing when God called him. He was actually working hard. He was working very diligently.
要表达的是神所选召的人是一个勤劳努力工作的人，不是一个懒惰好吃懒惰的人。
It tells us that God chose those who are hardworking and diligent, and not those who are lazy.
所以保罗就说了，那些不做工的不、哦、不给他饭吃嘛，不做工你吃什么饭呢、啊、
？That is why Paul said, "He who does not work, let him not eat."
那个重点就是说，我们每个人都要勤劳工作，要成为一个勤劳的人，殷勤的人。
The main point here is we must become diligent people.
哦，那么第二，我们看到基甸呢，他的第二个特色呢，他是很谨慎、很小心的，很谨慎的。
Second characteristic of Gideon is that he is very watchful.
哦，你看在此一节说，他在工作的时候呢，他在那边反被米甸人，看到吗？十一节下半段，他一边工作，一边反被提防米甸人，他很紧紧保持警醒。
And verse 11 tells us that while he was threshing wheat, on one hand he was threshing wheat, on the other hand he was trying to hide from the Midianites.
特别我们今天在这个末世哦。魔鬼这么多工作 要吞噬我们，要打击我们的时候，我们神的工人有没有保持高度的敏感呢？高度的警醒呢？
Especially in this era when the devil tried to oppress and attack us, do we have this kind of vigilant attitude?
很可惜啦、哦、传道真的发现到在教会有许多工人沉睡，就是看失去那种警醒的心呢。
But very pitifully, there are few in church who have fallen asleep and are not watchful.
那纵使有一些警醒的工人哦，提出哦有危险来到了，有撒旦的工作了，撒旦在教会了，他们都看不到这种事情。
There are some preachers who alerted the existence of the work of the devil in church, but there are others who are not able to see this.
甚至更糟糕是倒回来一直否认有 魔鬼的工作，一直好像是在保护着那个魔鬼的工作，不是在支持着神的工作。这个更让我们痛心跟糟糕的事呀。
On the contrary, what is more painful is that some of these people, they will try to be on the side of the devil, denying the work of the devil in church.
有一次传道提出、教会魔鬼在教会工作，那个是很有证据的，有真实的事情的。
There was once I pointed out the work of the devil in church.
哦，另一个圣职人员哦，他否认，他说传道乱讲，而且是要恐吓我们，要吓我们，让我们失去信心，破坏教会的这种平安，要对付，真的在对付，那是使我很痛心的事情。
But then another preacher pointed out that I was only trying to disrupt the peace in church and that there was no such thing as the existence of the devil in church.
这些事情就说明了、哦、一些工人真的是沉睡了，完全不知道他在做什么，也不知道魔鬼在做什么，不知道。
And this goes to show that some leaders, they do not know the work of the devil.
啊，你不知道你就听啊，你最少听那些警醒的传道、警醒的工人的警告嘛，是吗？你可以听啊，你不但是不听，你还是对付他，那不是很糟糕吗
？So the least they could do is just listen to what the preachers have to say.
那我们看到神拣选这个基甸的时候，这两个特色在他身上：勤劳、警醒。
So we can see these two points in Gideon. First is he was very diligent, and secondly he was very watchful.
那第三个呢？他很熟悉圣经的历史、信仰的历史，他很熟悉。
And thirdly, he was very familiar with the history of the Bible.
在第十三节
，in verse 13,
你看他讲他们的历史，以色列人的历史。哦，神怎样带领他们？神怎样与他们啊征战的那些历史，他清楚的述说呀。
And verse 13, we can see how familiar he was with the history of the Israelites and how God has brought all these miracles to deliver them.
今天有一些年轻人啊，说要当传道呀，要为神工作。你问他圣经，问他一些故事，他讲不出来呢。你怎样当传道哦？
Today, some youths want to be preachers, but if you ask them about the scriptures, they do not know. Then how can they be preachers?
所以为什么要考圣经呢？圣经知识要考啊，进神学院要考圣经知识。它的重点在这里。你原来你平时都没有关心这些信仰啊，这些圣经故事啊，很多你都没有关心的呀，你也不懂的呀。
So that is precisely why there should be tests For the people's sake, for the students' sake, so that they have to be more concerned for the affairs of the church.
最少选择进神学院，有一个要求是说，你有没有把整本圣经读完一次，讲一次就好，有没有读到完？不要有些人读很多次，只要求一次有没有？
And the minimum requirement.
这个神学院有要求的。
And there is this minimum requirement by the theological seminar, whether these youths, aspiring youths who wants to be preachers, whether they have read the Bible, the whole Bible at least once.
老师说，一些神学生，一些要当传道的，有没有呢？有没有做到这一点呢？可能没有。
Actually, those youths who want to be preachers, have they even read the Bible once?
那么，神选召基甸之前，他已经熟悉这些圣经历史了的。
So when God called Gideon, we can see that he was very familiar with the history of the Israelites.
第三呢，他也有关心同胞，有爱同胞的心呐，爱人的心呐。
And thirdly, we can see that he has this love for his people.
因为他向神提出嘛，神为什么丢弃我们？为什么将我们交给敌人、米甸人，让我们痛苦？这也是一种爱同胞、爱人的一种关怀。 神为什么你这样不？我们的同胞现在大家都很痛苦呀。Because
he asked God why God has forsaken them and not delivered them out of the hands of the Midianites. This is his love for his people.
如果你没有爱同胞的心，你不会提出这个问题的。那不关我的事啊，那管我什么事呀？If
he did not have this love for the people, he would not have brought this up.
那么他也算是谦卑。 当时他也是算是一个谦卑的人呐。
He is also a humble man.
你看他15节他讲的，他说我们的家，我们的这个支派都是贫穷的，而且这个支派都是微小的。他承认这一点呐，我们不是很厉害的，我们也不是背景很光荣的，我们是很微小的，很软弱的，最软弱的一个支派来的呀。
And verse 15, he was humble enough to say that his clan was the weakest in Manasseh and that he was the least in his father's house.
骄傲的人，他不会讲这种话。纵使他真的是很卑微的，他也把自己讲到很厉害、很威水，他不会讲这种话的。An
arrogant man would not be saying this kind of words. Even though he may be very lowly, he will try to exalt himself to a very high position.
他还有很多美点呢，我们自己去看呢。 神选召他的，为什么会选召他？他的优点在哪里？他信仰的美点在哪里？你自己看。We
can see he has many good characteristics, good virtues, and we can read them ourselves.
好，我们讲第三个角度，那个五件宝贵的真理。We
look at the other angle, five teachings that we can derive from this chapter.
第一个就是拆毁跟建造，它都有对比的，两个对比的。 一个是拆毁，一个是建造。拆毁跟建造，看到吗
？And the first one is a comparison. He demolished and then he rebuilt.
25节，他拆毁巴利的祭坛，有没有拆毁？And
verse 25 tells us that he tore down the altars of Baal.
可是26节，他却去建造神的祭坛。Verse
26 tells us that he built the altar for God.
这个是我们在信仰上今天要努力做的事。 要殷勤做的事。And
this is what we must diligently do today.
要拆毁撒旦的祭坛，偶像的祭坛，然后要努力建立神的祭坛。We must
tear down the altars of the devil, and we must diligently build an altar for God.
那如果你有兴趣，你看在这一章里面，这个基甸有四个祭坛，四个祭坛跟他都有关系的。
If you were to read on, you can see that there are four altars that is connected with him.
第一个祭坛在21节是神预备的祭坛。Verse
21 tells us of the altar that God has prepared.
神叫他把那些肉啊、那些无效饼啊放在盘子上。God
told him to
献祭给神，那个盘子是祭坛。God
told him to put the meat and the unleavened bread on this rock that. This wrong or this altar that God has prepared.
请注意，这个祭坛不是基甸建的，是神预备的。This
altar was not built by Gideon, but it was prepared by God.
很奇妙的，神预备祭坛。
So it is amazing that God has prepared this altar.
然后第二个奇妙就是火从哪里来？这里说，你注意看啊，二十一节，火从磐石中出来，磐石出火啊，看到吗？二十一节。
Verse 21 tells us, where does this fire come from? The fire actually came out of the rock.
哦，曾经在摩西时代，磐石出水嘛，打那个磐石，磐石会有水跑出来。现在哈，在基甸的时代，磐石出火也是奇妙的作为啊，奇妙的神迹啊。
During the time of Moses, we can see that out of the rock came forth water. And in this case, in Gideon, we can see that from the rock, there was fire that came out.
第二个祭坛叫做是平安，神是平安的坛。
The second altar is the altar of peace.
那是二十四节。
It is in verse 24.
那这个坛就是基甸建的，建给神的。基甸自己住的，住给神的。
This altar was built by Gideon for God.
那他把这个坛叫做耶和华沙龙，沙龙就是平安的意思，神是平安。
And he called the altar, the Lord, Jehovah Shalom.
第三个祭坛，那个就是假神的祭坛。
The third altar is the altar for the idols.
二十五节。
Is in verse 25.
这个祭坛是他父亲建立的，他的父亲建立的祭坛。
This altar was built by his own father.
但是不是拿来敬拜神的，是拿来敬拜偶像的。
And the altar was built by the father to worship the idols.
基甸却把这个坛摧毁了。
But Gideon tore down this altar.
那第四个祭坛呢，叫做整整齐齐的祭坛。
And the fourth one was a proper, the fourth altar was a proper one to God.
看到吗？二十六节。
In verse 26.
在这个磐石上，整整齐齐的为耶和华神筑一座坛，这叫做整整齐齐的坛，也是筑做给神，筑给神的。
Verse 26, we can see that he built an altar to God on top of the rock at the proper arrangement.
在这一章我们看到基甸的四个坛。
From this chapter, we can see the four altars in the book of Judges.
建造跟拆毁，拆毁跟建造。
Tearing down and building up.
那基甸的意思，他的名字意思叫做毁坏者、破坏者。
And the meaning of Gideon is to tear down.
或者是大能的战士、大能的勇士。
Or the great warrior.
真的，从他的名字看到，他是一个毁坏者。他毁坏什么？他毁坏偶像的祭坛，他摧毁偶像、魔鬼、撒旦一切的作为。他叫做
From his life, we can see that he actually tore down the altars of the devil, of the idols.
那么他的另一个名字叫做大能的勇士。他为了以色列国，他成为大能的勇士。他为了以色列人的信仰，成为大能的勇士。他为了真神，为着神来成为一个大能的勇士，有力量的勇士。
And his other meaning, his other name, that's the meaning of a great warrior. And because of the people of Israelites, he was a warrior for God.
这个就是基甸名字的意思。那他的工作真的是这样。
This is the meaning of the name of Gideon, and he manifested that in his life.
第二个对宝贵的真理就是真神跟假神。
And the other teaching is a true God and false gods.
自己看呐，哈，这真神在哪里，假神在哪里，自己看呐。
We can see where is the true God and where are the false gods from here.
那第三个哈真理呢，对比呢，就是迫害哈，比迫迫害与勇支持，勇在勇待就是支持。一种信徒，一般人呢是迫害他的，那一般人呢是支持他的。迫害跟支持都在一起，都在他的身上。
And the third one is the comparison between those who persecuted him and those who supported him.
看到吗？三十节有一般人要对付他，要杀死他。
Can you see in verse 30, there was one group of people who wanted to kill him.
另有一般人呢要支持他。那三十五节。
And in verse 35, we can see another group of people who supported him.
有时候我们做在圣公司，在今天末世真教会里面的工作当中、侍奉当中，也会面对这样：有一般人是要对付你的，有一般人是支持你的。支持你的就是支持神工作的，逼迫你的、对付你的就是破坏神工作的。
So we can see that even today, there are these two groups of people. One would be threatening and trying to oppose you, and the other one would be supporting you.
这种情形在教会看得到的，在今天就看得到的。
This is what we can see even today in our church.
那么再来第四个对比的真理就是分散跟合一，一种是分散，一种是合一的。
And the fourth one is to disperse and to be united.
那么在撒旦攻击的时候，敌人压迫的时候，大家都分散了，没有团结起来。
And during
the 大家各自过各自的生活，哦，好像一盘散沙，那是分散的。大家躲藏在山东，有些躲藏在地东，有些躲在哪里去，分散的。
And during the oppression of the enemies, you can see that the Israelites, they were all dispersed. Some were hiding themselves in the caves, some in the dens, and some in the strongholds of the mountain.
那当三十四节说圣灵动工的时候，神的灵动工的时候，就把那些分散的以色列人合一起来。
Verse 34 tells us that when the Spirit of God worked within them, we can see that they gathered them together to be united.
所以今天教会要真正的合一，还是要靠圣灵啊，要求圣灵动工啊，不然没有办法合一。
Today, for the church to be united, we need the power of the Holy Spirit to unite us.
那第五个对比的真理就是求证跟信心，求证据跟信心这两件事。
The fifth comparison.Is this asking for a sign and praying with faith?
因为有信心不足嘛，信心不足哦，信的不够，所以才需要神啊，求证据，给证据。这个叫做证据哈，跟信心的问题。
Because of his inadequate faith, he has to ask for a sign.
也不是说他完全不信神，不是，他是信的，可是信的不够。在新约圣经常说主啊，我信的不够。所以说你们是小信的人，这个是信仰上的一些弱点。
It doesn't mean that he had no faith, but rather he did not have the sufficient faith. That is why he asked for a sign. So in the New Testament, Jesus tells us that if we do not have enough faith, we must ask God.
所以他要求证据了，是吗？
And that is why he asked for a sign.
那还有一些就是你看十四节有一句话说：“耶和华观看基甸，神在看基甸。”
And the other one is in verse 14. God was watching over Gideon.
注意哦，神在看我们哦，特别我们要被神用的，或者说我们正在被神用的，神都在看着你。神看你，神看基甸，就是在看着我们今天神的工人呢。
So let's take note that God is also watching us today the same way He watched over Gideon.
十八节下半段最后一句说哦，神说：“我必等你。”神在等我们。
And verse 18, the last part, Jesus, God said, I will wait for you. Today, God is also waiting for us.
神说我等你回来。
God said, I will wait until you come back.
有一首歌的，我等着你回来，我等着你回来。神说我等你回来，因为基甸说神啊，我要去预备一些献祭的东西嘛。神说好，我等你回来。
At that time, Gideon said that he will go and prepare the offerings for God. So God told him that I will wait until you come back.
你向神承诺的，说要献奉献的，要替他做什么做什么，你都忘了。但神没有忘你，神说我还在，我等你回来啊，我都还在等你啊，等到今天你还没回来啊，神在等我们啊，看到吗？
When you promise to offer to God and to work for Him, God will tell you, "I will wait until you come back."
好了好了，祷告了，因为还有很多丰富的道理，祷告了，只剩下五分钟而已。
We have 5 more minutes. We shall pray now.